If you know what your strengths are, try and see how your strength can help you overcome your weakness. The same curiosity and energy you have in finding out the why behind this person, do that with numbers. And that was like mind-blowing for me.
Ketika kita nge-treat work kita as a play, dan ini bayangin ketika kita dulu masih kecil, when we do a lot of things tuh karena kita love doing it. But unfortunately, begitu kita kerja, seakan-akan dikondisikan bahwa kerja harus serius. Karena kalau tidak serius, berarti you are not doing your best. And what you suggested is to inject that element of play instead of work, so work can be more enjoyable.
Welcome to Follow Your Flow Podcast. Kita membantu lifelong learner untuk berproses menuju life model yang lebih optimal dan sustainable. Di sini, kita akan belajar dari banyak sumber, mulai dari lifelong learner yang kita interview, sampai insight yang gue dan Mbak Ika dapat dari buku, artikel, podcast, maupun hasil refleksi pribadi kami. Di akhir setiap episode, lo akan mendapatkan science back, pragmatic step, yang bisa membantu lo untuk mentransformasi hidup lo. Hope you enjoy this episode.
Alright, hai Da.
Halo, hai Pikario.
So thank you banget pada kesempatan kali ini gue memiliki kesempatan untuk ngobrol bareng Alda.
Yay, thank you for having me. Gantian nih kita ceritanya.
Iya, benar. Gitu. Jadi buat teman-teman yang belum dikenal sama Alda, Alda itu adalah associate di top management consulting firm, McKinsey & Company. Terus saat ini Alda juga lagi memulai bikin konten di social media. Itu Kartini Masa Kini Podcast, itu ada di Instagram dan ada juga di Spotify. Isinya primarily tentang women empowerment. Jadi kalau misalnya teman-teman tertarik, nanti gue akan kasih linknya juga buat ngunjungin kayak profilnya Alda. Gue kenal Alda mungkin berarti kurang lebih kayak 6 tahun yang lalu, right?
I think so.
Iya, yeah, waktu itu kita teman sekantor gitu kan. Dan kita mungkin waktu itu gak pernah kerja bareng. Tapi no. We bump into each other for so many times. Mungkin karena satu kantornya kecil gitu kan. Dan kayaknya gue dan Alda itu tipe orang yang suka berinteraksi dengan orang lain gitu. Jadinya kayak...
extroverted people problems ya.
Exactly gitu. And as time goes by, kayak one thing yang super konsisten tentang Alda adalah setiap kali gue ngobrol sama Alda, gue selalu dapat positive vibe gitu. No matter what content we are talking about. Sometimes it's about work, sometimes it's about kayak other things outside of work, kayak romantic relationship, or even kayak waktu-waktu gue di interview juga di podcastnya Alda. So it's always a good time with Alda. So that, thank you banget for taking your time to...
Sama-sama, Vicario. You know, it's always a super nice vibe with you. Like, I was gonna say the same thing. So, makasih banget udah having me here. I'm excited for our obrolan today.
Yeah. So, mungkin gini dah. Tadi kan gue udah ngenalin lo lebih dari kayak hal yang maybe publicly available. It's on LinkedIn, it's on Instagram, right? Maybe you can tell us a bit about yourself, about your childhood, gitu. Childhood mungkin kayak dari lo kecil sampai ya kuliah, gitu ya. Yang not many people know about.
Oh, got it. Okay. That's a very interesting question. Jarang juga ditanya kayak gitu. Yang not many people know about would probably be the fact that gue spend... By the way, ini gue lo gak apa-apa? Or aku kamu prefer?
Gak apa-apa banget. Gak apa-apa ya. Ini jaksel.
Jaksel, got it. Okay, so mungkin fakta about my childhood is the fact that gue spend most of my childhood di Myanmar, of all places in the world. Banyak yang nanya, hah kok bisa sampai Myanmar gitu kan? So the cerita adalah my father used to work for a French oil company gitu kan. So actually I was born in France. My first ever language yang my dad taught me was actually French. Tapi we lived there for only like 1-2 years and then kita semua pindah ke Myanmar and then I lived there for about 8-9 years plus or something like that. So it was like France, actually sempat ke Indonesia dulu, sebentar mampir ke Balikpapan, that's where my brother was born. And then I spent the most of my childhood di Myanmar. And then I only came to Indonesia itu pas SD kelas 6 gitu. It was a very... significant culture shock for me, to be honest. Kayak susah banget dapat teman, right? Kalau misalkan lu pindah, udah kayak SD kelas 6, yang kayak everybody udah ngegeng, meskipun ini SD, right? Like, it happened. So, it was a bit of a culture shock, iya. Terus kayak bingung juga bersosialisasi kayak gimana, dapat teman kayak gimana. But, eventually, you know, like, I apparently survived it. Terus nyemplunglah ke all girls school. Waktu itu gue di Santa Ursula Sanur, Jakarta, pos. So I did that for 6 years, SMP, SMA. Baru abis itu I had the opportunity to go to Australia buat kuliah di Melbourne University, both bachelor sama masters in marketing.
Actually, gue baru tahu ternyata lo spend vast majority of your childhood in Myanmar.
Oh really? Wow. I thought I told you before.
No. I mean like kalau lo lihat rekamannya nanti kayak I was so puzzled bahwa out of all place in world kayak wow ternyata lo besarnya di Myanmar gitu ya. Dan dari se follow up question gitu kayak well kalau ada ya kalau nggak ada juga nggak apa-apa gitu kayak how was the fact that you spend most of your childhood in Myanmar kayak affect you right now as you grow up as a person?
Ooh, interesting question. Mungkin the fact that waktu itu tuh kebetulan kita dicemplungin di sekolah di mana itu tuh anak-anak dari the same employees of the same company that my dad worked for, right? Jadi yeah. It was a very diverse school.
Oh, okay. Gitu. Okay.
Meskipun very very tiny. By the way, kalau lo bayangin ya, the entire SD, right, was like only 12 people max, kalau nggak salah. It's insane. I know. I used to be like top of my class all the time karena kayak saingan gue cuma satu orang doang by the way. And then my best friend was actually 3 years younger than me. Jadi kayak waktu itu gue kelas 5, dia kayak masih kelas 3 or something like that because he's the only girl in the school. But anyway, the big takeaway for me waktu itu adalah the fact that it was a very diverse school. Kayak me and my brother, we were the only Indonesians di situ. Yeah. Yeah. Yang lain itu mostly French, tapi ada juga yang kayak, you know, from like other places like Palestine or something like that. Like, I can't really remember. So, the fact that, you know, gue kayak ke-expose banget sama kayak different people. Awalnya susah banget sih, but then, you know what I'm saying? Kayak about your journey in life, terutama if you plunge into a company yang kayak pretty Western, dimana lo kayak harus, you know, you're exposed to people from so many different countries, apa segala macam. Even pas kuliah, kayak all of a sudden, you know, you're an international student, apa segala macam. So, at least it's something that I'm grateful for kali ya, karena udah kayak, kagetnya udah dari kecil gitu, kayak, orang mana nih, gitu. Terus kayak dipaksa bersosialisasi, I guess. I don't know if that counts.
I see. No, I mean like, to some extent itu menurut gue akan berdampak. I don't know ya, mungkin ini gue soto atau cocok logi gitu kan. Tapi kayak for a lot of people, obviously their childhood, kayak their upbringing itu akan mempengaruhi banget kayak how they view the world, kayak to some extent gitu. Wow, that's interesting. Karena kayak ya compare to myself ya, kalau gue sih ya biasa-biasa aja. Gue kan lahir dan besar di Bandung. Terus kayak ya sekolah gue ya isinya orang-orang yang sangat homogen gitu. Kayak orang yang rasnya sama kayak gue, agamanya sama. Tinggalnya di satu komplek perumahan. So I was actually raised in the very homogeneous environment. Dan baru kayak gue tuh pindah ke heterogennya kayak lebih diverse tuh ketika gue kuliah gitu kan. Karena gue kuliahnya di PTN, right? Tetapi kayak lo terexpose dari kayak that diverse environment since kayak lo dari kecil, which is very interesting.
Even though
12
it's not,
orang satu sekolah.
Exactly, even though it's not by my own choice ya. Itu kan bukan pilihan gue. Like literally bokap gue yang kayak ya udah cemplungin aja. Jadi kayak modal nekat from my parents juga, I guess.
Got it.
But very difficult waktu itu, but quite thankful for it.
Got it. I see. Nah, kalau gitu gue pengen ngebahas dulu nih. Kayak tadi kan udah ngebahas dari kayak sebelum you start working, right? Kayak when you started working, gue remember kayak you started in McKinsey tuh as a junior research analyst, which is like a different track from a consultant. Then from that moment, which is kayak mungkin kayak 6-7 years ago, right? Terus kayak akhirnya lo tetap di firm, and right now kayak lo udah menjadi associate on the consultant track gitu. Nah, maybe lo bisa ceritain sedikit deh, kayak how was the journey from that moment when you join as JRA, sampai akhirnya lo sekarang jadi associate. Associate tuh kayak kalau di McKinsey, it's more like a post-MBA role, gitu kan. Okay. Jadi buat teman-teman yang belum tahu, karena there is a bit of, you know, terminologies differences across consulting firm gitu kan. Karena kalau kayak di BCG, associate itu kayak sebelum MBA, tapi kalau di McKinsey, it's typically a role post-MBA. Just for context, for our listeners gitu. Nah, silahkan deh.
Mungkin sebelum nyampe ke JRA, would like to step back a bit kali ya, dan kayak ceritain sedikit juga, you know, nyampe ke JRA-nya seperti apa. Is there
Yes.
Yeah, so mungkin kayak banyak juga sih yang nggak tahu, but actually the first position itu tuh sebenarnya I always applied itu business analyst gitu kan. So pertama kali banget kayak ada recruiting ke Melbourne Uni dan sebagainya, sebenarnya gue apply-nya ke business analyst role kayak gitu. Jadi udah you know, I went through what a lot of people went through juga gitu kan, belajar mati-matian for like the written test, terus kayak ronde 1, 2, 3. Puji Tuhan banget kayak lolos all of the rounds kecuali ronde terakhir. So actually the first time I tried to apply itu aku di reject intinya kayak gitu, right? So they said at the time, oh kita belum siap nih untuk offer kamu posisi business analyst. Tetapi for the first time di cabang Indonesia ini, kita mau bentuk tim research nih gitu kan. Kita mau bentuk tim research nih. And then they asked me, would you be interested gitu kan. And then I said, di saat itu for some reason gue pikir, oh ya udah cuman kayak di switch doang posisinya. So I'm like, of course gitu kan. Like, gak taunya mesti interview lagi dari awal. Right, so I had to do all the different rounds again, apa segala macam. It was exactly the same type of interviewing segala macam, and then eventually, kemudian I got in gitu kan. So that's the cerita gitu. Kenapa tracknya adalah track research dulu gitu kan. But my first intention sebenarnya I always wanted to be a consultant gitu. So I think it was important to establish that karena memang dari dulu I just see myself as a consultant and I really want. It was my dream back then gitu kan. So ketika udah masuk ke situ, role-nya junior research analyst, kebetulan waktu itu gue di tim di mana it's pretty flexible, di mana kita juga dikasih pilihan antara kita boleh support multiple team at once, gitu kan, multiple project at once, and multiple consultants from different project at once, atau informally taking up responsibilities as an informal business analyst, right? Di mana kita
opportunity.
Itu kayak that's the fancy word, exactly. That's step up opportunity kalau misalkan kita mau, you know, orangnya tipenya yang nyari sakit gitu kan, kayak menyemplungkan diri ke ya udah, you know, kayak I'm happy to help you out in a project. Dan waktu itu what's quite interesting and memorable for me adalah gimana caranya dari kayak BAU responsibilities as a researcher tiba-tiba kecemplung di being, you know, an informal business analyst. It's all thanks to networking, Vicario. So, and networkingnya bukan yang kayak serius banget gitu-gitu. No, it was literally an office party. And then I remember one of my role models in the firm itu, she was an engagement manager from the States. Dan dia kayak banyak nge-handle marketing project gitu-gitu. Nah, in one of the office events, kayak, you know, everybody was having fun, there was drinks here and there, and then I decided to build the courage untuk kayak approach this person. And then I said, hey, you know, what are you working on? Gue dulu kayak belajar marketing, apa segala macam. If you need any research help at all for your project, please let me know, gitu kan. Then, ternyata, kayak, I can't remember beberapa weeks or like months later, akhirnya dia email gue, gitu kan. Kayak, hey, you, do you want to help us out? I can actually staff you full-time, gini-gini-gini. So that was really the beginning, it was my year one, kalau nggak salah. And then selama 2 tahun setelah itu, ya puji Tuhan, you know, like maybe she was happy with my work and then she was referring me to other engagement managers. That's how I kept on getting the remaining informal opportunities juga, gitu kan. Setelah itu, the person that really made me to do the switch atau even trigger the idea in my mind was actually now one of my all-time mentor and sponsor juga. He recently became a senior partner. He is one of the leaders in the oil and gas industry. Dia yang nanya, kayak, by the way, have you considered switching tracks? Gitu, because it seems like you really enjoy what you do, apa segala macam kayak gitu-gitu. So, long story short, akhirnya it's really about voicing out what I wanted, right? Dari dulu pengen banget, asking for guidance juga, gimana nih caranya supaya I can switch tracks. And by the way, at the time juga belum ada formal mechanism untuk switching tracks.
Wow.
But you know, thanks to mentors and sponsors, like, you know, they made it happen lah, gitu sih, long story short. So eventually, yeah, I got the position that I initially wanted, right? And I'm still stuck here. So, gak tahu nih kedepannya bakal kayak gimana, but at least I'm still here now.
Wow. Thank you banget for sharing that story. Gitu. Tadi kayak waktu gue denger dari lo, menurut gue there are a lot of things yang, okay, mungkin si konteks lo agak-agak spesifik di management consulting firm ya. Tapi let me make this general, dan sebenarnya ini sangat applicable buat banyak orang. Right? I think number one, what you did adalah, lo bahkan mengadmit tidak ada formal mechanism at that time, tapi you are actually paving your own road.
Sort of, thanks to my mentors, yeah.
Exactly right. Maksud gue kayak, of course, kayak ada mentor yang membantu lo untuk membukakan jalan. Tapi mentor itu gak akan tahu kalau lo gak reach out terlebih dahulu. Karena mungkin kayak mereka mikir kayak, oh ya udahlah, dia di research, mungkin dia mau di research aja terus-terusan gitu kan. Yeah. And that's also like a choice, right? And the fact that you had the courage untuk ngomong and reach out to that person, dan akhirnya ternyata gayung bersambut, dia kayak memberikan lo kesempatan, it's actually amazing. Karena menurut gue di banyak kesempatan ketika kita ngelihat bahwa, okay, there is no way, karena gak ada formal mechanism, kayak siapa gue gitu kan, kayak again, dia kan udah experience banget di MNS gitu kan, di marketing and sales, terus kayak siapa gue gitu kan. I think that's like a lot of doubts that a lot of people had, including myself to some extent gitu. Tapi menurut gue the fact that you kayak just go for it gitu.
Yeah,
itu menurut gue sangat-sangat admirable.
Thank you so much, Vicario. You make it sound so easy, but in fact, it was so scary, right? Makanya it also took me kayak quite a long time, right? Kayak itu 3 years to meet. It's quite a long time to even kayak realize that. I know a lot of people yang benar-benar inspire me in a sense that once they know what they want, they really just kayak go for it and go for it fiercely gitu, right? I honestly dealt with a lot of insecurities juga waktu itu gitu kan. Because of the first rejection, right? Because of you know, kayak imposter syndrome, you know, name all of those things lah yang kita semua alamin in our first year of career. Tapi like you said, I think you're right, right? The reason kenapa gue lebih berani untuk voice it out juga is because my surroundings kebetulan ada juga people yang recognize our work gitu kan. So it made it easier gitu.
Got it. And to add to that, Da, what are some of your tips untuk orang yang mungkin on the fence karena mereka sudah menemukan nih siapa role model mereka dan kayak they already know but they just need a bit of didorong sedikit gitu loh. Kayak, what would be your tips to people who are on that situation?
Number one, step zero mungkin ini ya, stay true to yourself gitu, yang pertama. Kayak, try and gali what is it that you want, even though it's not very clear, tapi at least kayak dengerin kata hati gitu. Dan benar-benar dengerin kata hati, dan gak dengerin kata-kata orang, or what you think would be cool di mata orang-orang. Could be that something yang super mainstream, is like it looks, you know, cool apa segala macam, tapi it could be different with your kata hati. So, number one is know what you want. Number two, like you said, Vicario, it's more on finding a role model or someone yang share similar interest gitu. Yang mungkin journey-nya tuh inspire you, someone yang you aspire to be gitu kan. Dan tip nomor tiga mungkin yang paling susah ya, at least it was paling susah for me, is have the courage to just reach out aja and like start a conversation gitu. Banyak orang yang kayak jiper gitu kan, Vicario, kayak ini orang senior partner man kayak, or ini orang oh my god, you know, direktur mungkin ya kalau di tempat lain, or ini orang tuh kayak founder of this company, of our company, like how, siapa gue gitu kayak, mereka mau ngobrol sama gue gitu kan. But most often than not, these leaders could actually be the people yang care a lot when it comes to more junior people showing up gitu kan and voicing out their concerns apa segala macam. So you'd be surprised the kinds of conversations yang you will get when you start reaching out to people. So just start reaching out. Map dulu nih siapa aja gitu kan. Do a bit of a stakeholder mapping. Mulai dari colleagues yang your first degree colleagues, the people you work with, atau friends of friends gitu kan. And just start reaching out. You'll be inspired beneran.
Wow. Thank you banget for sharing that. Karena kayak recently gue sadar juga bahwa I think a lot of ambitious people, they don't have problem with grit. Karena begitu ada jalannya, they just gonna kayak just push through dan maju terus gitu kan. Sometimes kayak the challenge adalah menemukan jalannya atau kayak jalan mana nih yang harus gue pilih dan kayak memulai untuk masuk ke sana. So I think you combine those two things. Karena kalau gue dengar dari penjelasan lo kan kayak you work hard to be accepted dan waktu-waktu lo apply pertama kali juga gitu kan. So I assume bahwa sebenarnya kayak grittiness is already something yang mungkin comes kayak quite natural to you. Ya kan? Tapi kayak grittiness tanpa ada juga kayak perpindahan track dan juga you know that moment yang benar-benar pivotal banget to change juga akhirnya bakal stuck di satu tempat aja gitu kan.
Yeah, so, I like that a lot, Vicario. I think it's about the, you know, the saying of know what you want, but be flexible in getting it. Gitu kan. So, itu aja sih. Diingat aja kalau if there's something yang kita udah tahu banget kita pengen apa, don't be so harsh on ourselves juga that, you know, there's only one way to get there. Like, no. Right? Sometimes kayak journeys happen for a reason, right? Siapa tahu misalnya for me, right, my biggest reflection adalah mungkin ketika, let's say, gue keterima saat itu, but actually I'm not really ready skills-wise. Maybe, like, yeah. I wouldn't survive even 3 months, gitu kan. And then I will just kayak quit, gitu. So maybe, like, I don't know. Maybe itu something yang kayak untuk menghibur diri gue aja kali ya. You know, everything happens for a reason. But yeah, to some extent, I really believe that's the case.
Yeah. And actually, I want to double click on that. Nah. Karena kan tadi kayak, I think you tell ya, your role model bahwa lo available gitu kan, dan dia kayak giving you the chance. Yeah. Tapi kayak hipotesis gue, transition ini tidak terjadi dengan kayak langsung mulus-mulus aja gitu kan. Kayak gue mengekstrapolate bahwa your role kan sebelumnya lebih kayak internal facing. Now jadi konsultan agak-agak lebih external facing, belum lagi perlu lebih banyak number crunching gitu kan.
Yes, totally.
Exactly, right. Jadi kayak I believe there might be some adjustments along the way gitu kan. Maybe wanna ask you lebih kayak, how was the adjustment? Dan kalau misalnya waktu itu ternyata it was difficult, kayak what made you persevere?
Okay. So, the adjustments that I had to make. Okay, I'm gonna be very real with everyone here, right? Ketika kita sebagai junior consultant, like you said, it's pretty data heavy, right? What I realized adalah, yang di-require sebagai skill untuk kayak junior consultant was not my strength at all. I am not a data person, people. Like, far from it. Pas SMA, gue bahkan mesti naik banding. I actually was IPS gitu kan. And itu pun kayak naik banding. I was actually supposed to like masuk bahasa because I'm more of a creative person. So that's just how far I am from like anything related to data, okay? Like ketika remet fisika, itu kayak oh my goodness, kayak gila apa. Like it's insane. So itu huge shock for me, right? The fact that, I mean, of course, you cannot shy away, you cannot run away from hadapin all of these data that you have to deal with, benar-benar. Generating insights from that, apa segala macam kayak gitu-gitu. It's just not natural for me. For me, gue tuh lebih ke orang yang kayak, I think you would know juga, like, you know, I'm more of a people person, I love communication, apa segala macam gitu-gitu. So, the first year was very hard for me, because gue jadi makin insecure, to be honest. And I'm not gonna lie to you, kayak, I used to be the kind of person yang compare myself to other people a lot. Apalagi ngelihat kayak, you know, all the BAs and the associates yang kayak udah doing their own thing, padahal mereka pun kayak gak master, gak anything, right? It's so hard, like, you know, you get these thoughts in your head every day, and then you start imposter syndrome kicks in, kayak, oh my gosh, you know, was I doing this by luck or not, you know, so I had to deal with all of those thoughts, kayak, you know, but like you said, Vicario, I think if you really know what is it that you want, then ketika kita punya grit, it becomes a bit easier, dalam arti, kalau kita memberanikan diri untuk shut out all of those thoughts yang tidak konstruktif, right? And just stay true to who you are. The fact that, you know, start accepting who you are truly and be your most authentic self. What I mean by that adalah gini. Understand where your strengths are, right? Understand where your weaknesses are. Nah, and then try and, number one, overcome those weaknesses to kayak gimana. If you're someone who really wants to achieve something, for sure, kalian tuh pasti pengen learn about that thing, right? Pengen learn to be better at your weaknesses. So, naturally, what you want to do is ask a more senior person to teach you, even if it comes to a simple Excel formula, right? And then walk your way up from there. Even when it comes to, like, there's, like, this really complicated chart, and then you have no idea what it means, right? At least start with your view first, and then kayak reiterate it with someone else. Intinya kayak have the spirit of learning and wanting to get better. Like, be bold in that. Itu untuk overcome your weaknesses, right? But gue mau share tip yang, it's a tip that I will remember for life. And this was given by my all-time mentor juga, Filia Wibowo, which is the managing partner of Kinzi Indonesia. Yeah. She said to me, if you know what your strengths are, try and see how your strength can help you overcome your weakness. Right? In my case, my strength adalah really understanding the most underlying deep mindset in people. Right? Kayak asking multiple layers of why. When I talk to someone that is even a very difficult person, for some reason, I'm just able to crack, gitu kan, kayak this person aja gitu. I'm still learning, of course, but it's something that is more natural to me. You know what I'm saying? Like, interviewing people like you, Vicario, it's an amazing skill that you have, right? It's some people just are more natural in that. Nah, what she said to me was this, the same curiosity and energy you have in finding out the why behind this person, do that with numbers. And that was like mind-blowing for me. Because it's like, it's the same thing, right? It's like, kok this trend doesn't make sense ya? Kenapa ya? Kenapa ya? Kenapa ya? Kenapa ya? Kenapa ya? And then you will eventually get to the root cause. You see what I mean? So it's like, that's just one of the biggest amazing tip that I learned myself, is that own who you are, accept gitu kan, and then try and use your strength untuk overcome your weakness. So that was it for me, sih.
Wow, that's actually a really, really, really good advice, though.
Ya kan? I also loved it so much.
exactly. Karena gini, kayak kalau gue bedah sedikit ya tadi apa yang dibilang sama Filia gitu ya. I think that's very powerful karena gini, kayak I think like maybe I can relate to some extent karena I consider myself better with people than with numbers gitu kan. Although I had my engineering degree, so sorry my so.
I think you're just being humble, Vicario.
So jadi kayak basically yang gue suka banget tadi itu adalah gimana kayak kayak that level of curiosity and passion that you have for people itu kan something yang bisa lo bayangkan. Now change the subject from people to numbers, gitu kan? Somehow itu jadi less daunting than just dari awal kayak people number. Of course people number is so boring. People are more interesting, gitu kan? Tapi ketika di approach dari angle on what excites us more, itu masuknya lebih gampang gitu. And kita jadinya nggak punya langsung mental block that this is like a something that's not exciting, gitu.
Absolutely. And if I may add on, Rea Vicario, ini tuh the same thing as finding things that energize you even outside of work. Then apply it into your work, gitu. Misalnya ya, aku kasih contoh. If you find yourself suka nge-lead conversations, right?
Whether it's
on Clubhouse or like whatever community, gitu kan. Or if you like podcasting, misalnya pas segala macam, and you want to learn that skill, and then you find yourself in a situation di mana kayak at work, you get very nervous ketika ada kayak big meeting, right? With scary, intimidating people yang udah very, very senior. Well, you know, imagine yourself as moderating a Clubhouse session aja gitu kan. Like literally, because you have to naturally be curious, right? And insights dari these different people, apa segala macam. To me, that also helped me, gitu. It's kind of weird as a tip, right? Like, treat your meetings like a Clubhouse session. But it really helps, honestly, Vicario. Apalagi ketika gue nervous banget gitu kan. But I just treat people as kayak, yaudah, you know, these people are interesting aja. And then just do it with your heart. It makes a difference.
No, but I think that makes a lot of sense gitu loh. Karena kayak I think another strategi yang tadi baru lo share gitu adalah kayak even like finding things that you like outside of work and treat that work situation as if you are on that non-work. Exactly. Sebenarnya itu tuh kayak related banget sama the theory of intrinsic motivation. Karena misalnya ini I wouldn't go deep into intrinsic motivation, tapi intrinsic motivation itu kayak kita ngebahas tentang play, purpose, and potential. Jadi kalau misalnya kita ngomongin purpose, it's more like, you know, serving something bigger than ourselves. Kalau potential, basically we are getting better as a person and as a professionals. Nah, tapi elemen yang paling powerful sebenarnya adalah play. Ketika kita nge-treat work kita as a play, dan ini bayangin ketika kita dulu masih kecil, when we do a lot of things tuh karena kita love doing it because we do it as a play. But unfortunately, begitu kita kerja seakan-akan dikondisikan bahwa kerja harus serius. Karena kalau tidak serius berarti you are not doing your best. Yes. Gitu kan? Kayak, padahal sebenarnya what you did and what you suggested is to inject that element of play instead of work, so work can be more enjoyable.
Yes, absolutely. I love that. Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah. Dan maksud gue kayak, well, I might go too far by saying this, tapi menurut gue kayak, kalau misalnya lo punya kebiasaan kayak gitu, no wonder lo bisa stay lama di dalam firm yang sebenarnya it's a quite kayak high pressure environment gitu kan, very competitive, long hours gitu kan. Tapi if you actively find opportunities like that, menurut gue I'm not surprised lo kayak bisa lama di firm gitu.
Okay, I knew this point was gonna come up, right? I think, honestly, itu tuh kayak campuran banyak hal sih, Vicario. Kayak the fact that, first of all, I am not a risk taker. Okay, so I applaud all of my friends, including you, yang kayak exited the firm and go and, you know, into the unknown, out of our bubble comfort zone. I really applaud that because to me, there's an element of me yang kayak very, I'm not a risk taker, right? But the other point that you mentioned, itu bener banget sih, Vicario. I think what keeps me going, yaitu finding my moments of energy boosts gitu kan. Finding my sources of energy, dan kalau gue boleh share juga, ini juga throughout the years semakin kerasa ya. And I shared this pas ngobrol sama Kak Gita waktu itu, yang I think you tuned in as well. It's the fact that my journey in the firm, gue juga menemukan passion-passion gue akhirnya dengan plunging myself into a lot of different activities ya. Jadi mungkin buat teman-teman yang belum tahu juga, di kantor yang I currently work in, banyak sekali opportunity-opportunity yang kayak sifatnya lebih ke kayak volunteering activities. Kayak misalnya banyak konsultan yang akhirnya help to coach young leaders for Indonesia participants gitu kan. Nah, in my case, I also had the amazing opportunity to do that. Dan disitulah mulai kayak ngerasa, wow, I love leadership, I love mentorship, and I love coaching gitu kan. Dan honestly, both in my work dan in my personal life, I love doing that gitu. Jadi I find that in my day-to-day gitu kan. Because I love leadership, the beauty about my current role is that I get to see juga kan different styles of leadership dari satu project ke project yang lain, dari satu client ke client yang lain. Dan in terms of mentoring and coaching, that's what I get to do for the working team juga gitu kan, from the client side atau you know more junior people. So despite all the crazy long hours, kayak lo bilang tadi, it's really, it comes back to the passion sih. What are the energizers yang keeps me going? So far ya, so far.
Wow. Thanks for sharing that, Da. Dan jadi menurut gue kayak you share like the full spectrum of strategy juga gitu kan. Kayak how to thrive in the high pressure environment. Nah, gue pengen shift the gear a bit dan juga pengen ngomongin tentang kayak your activity outside of work gitu. So you recently started Kartini Masa Kini Podcast gitu kan. Yes. Nah, mungkin lo udah share juga tadi sebagian, tapi pengen dengar lagi dong dari lo kayak sebenarnya what made you started that podcast?
Good. So ini mungkin tadi tuh sebenarnya transisi yang bagus juga sih untuk menjawab pertanyaan ini, right? The fact that berangkatnya dari passion. Passion di mana I'm passionate about leadership, I'm passionate about coaching, and I'm passionate about mentoring gitu kan. Dan so number one is kayak I discovered what my passions were. Number two was that semakin gue beranjak, you know, semakin I spend my journey as a career woman gitu kan, semakin terekspos juga gue akan isu-isu of being a woman in corporate, right? And semakin gue banyak belajar tentang ini, semakin ke-expose on these different experiences, semakin juga I became aware on the many issues on this front gitu kan, when it comes to gender inequality, terutama in Indonesia gitu. So I started reading up on research yang dikeluarin dari the company I work for. I started reading also, definitely I'm not a gender equality activist, right? But at least because it's a topic yang interest me, gue mencoba untuk kayak belajar tentang itu gitu kan. So once I became more aware of this issue, right, the fact that the gap is huge gitu kan, when it comes to women participation rate ketika kita masuk nih the workforce as juniors, itu tuh pretty balanced, right, antara men and female, men and women. Ketika masuk managerial position, itu tuh agak jomplang, the participation rate of women itu jadi kayak belasan gitu. And then when it comes to kayak board membership, itu cuman kayak 5%, not even, right? So itu berangkat dari situ aja. Sementara, why is this an issue, right? Ternyata, dari riset yang gue baca juga, sebenarnya kalau misalkan a company itu lebih gender diverse, it can actually yield financial benefits for the company, gitu. So there's absolutely no reason kenapa companies should not take this issue seriously, gitu kan. There's absolutely no reason kenapa we should not encourage more diverse backgrounds in the leadership position, gitu kan. So it was an issue yang really triggered me. Dikombin juga dengan my passion of coaching and mentoring, di mana jadi gini, a bit of context, ketika gue masuk dunia kerja, I didn't have a bigger sister figure, gitu, right? Men banyak, right? So I learn a lot from them, right? Tapi kan tentunya gak bisa dipungkiri bahwa banyak sekali problem that women face yang belum tentu men face, gitu kan. So I didn't have a bigger sister figure. So kayak, udah kayak, you know, menjeblokkan diri ke kayak tembok ini, tembok itu dengan sendirinya, right? Like learning on my own. Nah, what I realize adalah opportunities kayak misalnya bantu-bantu di Young Leaders for Indonesia, di mana kita kayak ngebantu tim gitu kan. A lot of them ternyata bilang kayak, wow, you know, Kalda, you know what you shared with me applicable banget nih gitu. Nah, disitulah gue mulai mikir kayak, you know what, why do these tips itu cuman harus available for my mentees yang dari formal platforms, contohnya YLI, and then I'm also a mentor di Women Works, I'm also a mentor di Ask Alumni Program di Melbourne University kan kebetulan. Hmm. And then I realized, you know what, in this modern age, ada namanya Spotify Podcast, Che.
Yes, yes.
Why shouldn't I offer the opportunity untuk a bigger audience juga untuk mendengarin gitu kan? By the way, I'm talking as if kayak audience gue banyak banget. No, right? Not yet. I hope to be, you know, I aspire it to be kalau misalkan emang ini, but I focus more on the fact that, you know, at least whatever I learn, kayak stories aja deh, mulai dari stories, we can start sharing it with other people, and hopefully the ripple effect juga semakin luas gitu kan. Starting things at my own capacity aja gitu. So that's the story kenapa gue mulai kali ini masak ini podcast Vicario.
Wow. Thanks for explaining that. Karena menurut gue akhirnya di situ yang gue tangkep ya, esensinya it's just a combination of passion and purpose. Karena you have the passion of coaching, mentoring, and helping others, and you have the purpose yang sebenarnya didasari dari your own pain points, right? Mm. Kayak you face the struggle as a woman entering the corporate world, yes. Terus tapi kayak how can we make it easy for more women, gitu kan? Yes. Karena seperti yang lo bilang, there is a solid business case for it. And of course, sebenarnya kayak gue pun pro into like maximizing option and access for people. Kayak one thing yang sebenarnya kayak kenapa isu ini pun juga lumayan masuk ke gue, selain kayak what I shared in your podcast, kayak keluarga gue kayak ada a lot of strong women. Ketika gue intern di Unilever 9 tahun yang lalu, waktu itu gue di tim HR-nya, my final project was about doing like a campaign to promote more women going to factory.
Thanks.
Gitu. Karena, dan waktu itu jadinya gue mendalami dong, maksud gue kayak, kenapa nih corporations tuh pengen lebih banyak women gitu kan. Makanya jadi kayak case-case yang kayak tadi lo bilang, itu tuh sebenarnya studi-studi yang gue udah baca juga dari, berarti kayak sekitar 9 tahun yang lalu gitu. And the fact that you also kayak read that recently, itu berarti kan konsisten kan findingnya.
Exactly.
That, you know, having a more inclusive workplace, itu sebenarnya beneficial for the business, and of course beneficial for like the people themselves, for women, and to some extent for men gitu kan.
Ya, benar banget. Yes, indeed.
Now kayak while that idea like sounds very grand gitu kan. Karena kan kalau kita ngomong gender equality, kayak wah gimana dong kan kita mesti breaking the stereotype, there needs to be like a formal processes and stuff gitu kayak. Which is a bit more like again relying to a lot of external factors larger than us. Mungkin kayak if you can share us a couple of tips gitu as individuals. Sebagai cowok, sebagai cewek, sebagai manusia gitu ya. Kayak what can we do? Like the practical tips to promote gender equality, baik itu di kerjaan ataupun misalnya kayak di lingkungan pertemanan.
Right. Number one would be reading up more about it. Yeah. Hmm. Jadi gender inequality or gender equality, the aspiration itu tuh a very wide topic. I am not an expert myself, right? And I still want to learn more and more about it. Kayak gitu. So kalau misalnya itu memang topik yang interests you and you think you can take a role in it. Or maybe not, just read up more about it aja. Caranya kayak gimana, like you said, mungkin bisa mulai dari research-research gitu kan, yang available publicly online. A lot of even, you know, consulting firms publish these things for free juga gitu kan. So you can always log on to their website gitu kan, that's a pretty credible source. Tapi juga start following communities yang udah formally dedicating their purpose to this, right? So banyak banget lah, kalau misalkan di Indonesia ada namanya IDSWI, kayak gitu-gitu. Find what those communities are and literally hit that follow button aja on Instagram, you will find like daily feeds, udahan gitu kan, super low effort. Kemudian try and define what you can already do within your own capacity. Gitu. A lot of people nanya juga ke gue Vicario kayak, oh you know, what if I really wanna be part of this women empowerment movement, but like you said, the ideas itu very very grand. My personal, I mean, and by the way, to each their own, right? Kalau misalkan you wanna, ini contoh ekstrim, if you wanna quit your entire job and then like build a foundation on your own, apa segala macam, ya by all means, right? No one's gonna stop you and good for you. But ketika kita tidak di posisi where that's possible, well then start within your own capacity. Maksud gue adalah mulai aja dari, let's say, I'm assuming kita kerja in a corporate gitu kan, reflect aja what you can do there, right? Misalnya start with the problems that you hear around you. Right? Kalau misalkan lo lagi, you know, ngobrol-ngobrol with your friends, right? And then you hear, kenapa ya kok di kantor ini belum ada program ini? Eh, kita boleh gak sih kayak gini gitu? Atau as simple as, wow, you know, that person is super inspiring, you know, that female leader gitu. Or that male leader is extremely active in promoting women gitu kan, and opportunities for women. Be very aware of who those people are and know that it doesn't take much untuk magnify their stories loh ke other people. It literally takes one Zoom meeting, teman-teman. Ya gak sih? Kayak, and that's honestly how it started di the company that I currently work for, right? Mm. Jadi, it literally started that way. Kayak a group of passionate women yang face a lot of problems gitu kan. Women in consulting, I think a lot of people know it can be a bit difficult. And then we also saw women making it to the top, right? So what we try to do adalah simple as gathering a bunch of people aja, kayak informal office hour, and then start doing fireside chats misalnya, right? Dimana kayak, okay, those leaders share very intimate personal stories to your company. It doesn't take much to do that, right? All it takes is this intention, right? And action juga. Pro tip would be try and find people with authority yang can make things happen for you. Right? Jadi kayak misalnya someone yang udah on top and then would sponsor you in these kind of, if you want to establish your own community, right? Your own women community, by all means. Kayak gitu. So again, it's about pulling the right people in juga and really understand that you cannot do change on your own. Right? You cannot. Like, give me an example of someone who did change on their own. I cannot, right? Yeah, so start pulling people in. Don't overthink and just start. Kembali lagi kayak tadi ya, start.
I like that takeaway. Karena kadang-kadang kita mikirnya langsung kayak, wah, how can I create a world dimana kayak langsung kayak cewek dan cowok semuanya equal, or kayak it's just like pure gender equality kayak everywhere, right? Tapi kayak we forget that, yes, there is kayak a lot of things that we can actually start doing. Gitu kan, by, gak usah jauh-jauh, maksudnya gue kayak, it's Instagram, just follow, jadi kita lebih aware gitu kan, even for some terms, karena kayak, I'm so lucky, karena recently, mulai banyak kayak orang-orang dengan background yang berbeda, yang masuk ke kantor gue juga gitu ya, jadi kayak gue ngedengar kata-kata mansplaining, atau kayak ngedengar kayak kata, misalnya contohnya kayak, apa ya waktu itu ya, kayak microaggression, right? Itu jadi kayak, oh wow, hal-hal kayak gitu tuh ternyata ada ya, karena kadang-kadang, if we live in the culture yang lumayan patriarki, ujung-ujungnya hal kayak gitu kan jadi ternormalize ya. Yang kayak pada akhirnya itu kita gak ngerasa bahwa, oh that's actually not right, or that
it's
can be.
Okay.
Exactly gitu loh. Karena kita terlalu ternormalize gitu kan.
Yes.
Right. And so I think dapat informasi gitu tuh kayak ngebantu juga untuk pelan-pelan question gitu.
Absolutely, Vicario. And I think you read my mind, see. That was literally the thing yang I wanted to add, right? The fact that the more you read up and make yourself aware about apa sih yang tergolong kategori tidak okay, the more you would know what to do about it. And this comes back to yang kita omongin juga, right, in our podcast waktu itu. Dimana lu bilang, you know, kayak people can start calling things out easier gitu kan. And it's also important, maksudnya mungkin tadi gue koreksi sedikit ya. If you want to do something, it doesn't have to even be something kayak as a complex starting your own community or anything like that. No. It's you need to role model the best practices yourself aja dulu. Right? And I don't care if you're a woman or a man. It goes out to everyone.
Yeah.
If you're a woman, for example, right, and you don't see any inspiring female leaders in the company you work for, well, then be that inspiring female leader. You don't have to wait until you get a managerial position, right? Title is nothing, gitu. Kayak, as junior as you are, you're still a leader, gitu, right? You can still lead yourself, you can lead the people around you, you can lead change, you can lead impact in the company you work for. Be that person. Be that person di mana, you know, kayak, more junior people coming in, kayak, will look up to you and be like, oh my gosh, you know, I want to be her. If you're a man, and you don't see a female leader with you, assuming you're already at the top, well, then have the courage and ask yourself, you know, what can I do to fix this? What opportunities can I do to create, gitu kan? To make the pipeline smoother untuk women. Who, siapa ya kayak in my team member, the female yang I haven't spoken to yet, right? Do I really know these people personally or not? Or, you know, do I treat them as, ya udah kayak someone who makes pretty slides for me?
exactly.
So, yeah. lebih ke kayak introspeksi diri aja kayak gitu. It helps.
Wow, that's powerful, Da. Karena takeaway-nya adalah do the best you can within your capacity. Right?
Yeah.
Karena kayak if you're just like, you know, like an employee or just like someone, kayak you become a role model. Kalau misalnya you are someone who is like a company leader and you have access to make changes within your environment, then do it. Kalau even sometimes you have the luxury to quit your job and create an NGO and promote this, then do it, gitu kan. Jadi kayak basically takeaway-nya adalah do whatever you can in your own capacity.
Your own capacity, that's right.
Wow, that's very practical. Dan to add to that, right, supaya sebenarnya di sini tuh nggak ada persepsi bahwa this is just for women, right? Because again, I can talk about this topic for so many hours.
I know.
Right? But when it comes to gender equality, there is also like, it's also going to benefit men, by the way. Karena kadang-kadang kita sebagai cowok pun juga terperangkap terhadap sebuah stereotype on how a man should behave. For example, we shouldn't cry or we shouldn't look weak, gitu loh. Yang seakan-akan kayak kita tuh harus selalu kuat, gitu. Kayak repeatedly I heard ketika dulu gue high school, gitu kan. Atau misalnya ketika gue lebih muda, di mana kayak lingkungan gue agak-agak lebih homogenis, dibilang kayak, aduh, jadi cowok jangan cengeng. Jadi cowok tuh harus tangguh, kayak gitu kan. I don't think that is also like inclusive, karena sebagai cowok juga, I think we have feelings. It's not that we don't have feelings, it's just we are conditioned to channel our feelings or emotion in a different way. Ya, dimana kadang-kadang kayak, oh, lebih keren kalau cowok itu kayak cool dan tidak berperasaan, kayak gitu kan.
Absolutely. So,
jadi maksud gue kayak maybe practical tips for that situation adalah to stop stereotyping on what men and women should or shouldn't do gitu.
Yes.
Karena as men, kalau misalnya memang kayak crying is an expression of emotion, ya do it. Makanya dulu gue excited banget ketika di Australia itu beberapa tahun lalu sempat ada sebuah movement di mana mempromot men to cry. And it was primarily karena waktu itu suicide rate-nya cowok tuh lagi tinggi banget. Dan probably it happened karena cowok itu dipaksa untuk memendam perasaan kita gitu loh. Right, so jadi kayak if you are sad, if you are depressed, if you really need to cry and cry.
I like that so much, Vicario. And this point reminded me of the most inspiring men leaders in the company I work for right now are actually the ones yang kayak unapologetically who they are as a family person banget gitu. Kayak, you know, kan a lot of people kayak societal expectations kayak for fathers with newborn babies. They're expected to come back to work because they're not the ones yang taking care of the babies, right? Tapi the men yang inspire me a lot, right, as leaders adalah the one yang kayak, ya udah kayak, they just don't care. Kayak gak, you know, they take longer breaks. Ketika, you know, lagi kerja bareng, mereka yang jadi kayak bener-bener, you know, what society perceive as the working mom definition, right? Kayak, people, I really need to stop this meeting at 6 because I want to spend time with my baby, you know? And these are coming from men. And to me, that's just so inspiring aja, you know, the fact that they wanna like break the stereotype juga kayak gitu and set out a very good examples for the next generation. So yeah. Break stereotypes.
Yeah, and more people like that akan membuat itu adalah hal yang normal gitu.
Right? Yes.
Mungkin awal kayak that's not normal gitu, tapi kayak more people doing that. Karena just to add one anecdote to that, I had a call with one of my engineering leader. Terus pas di tengah-tengah call tuh dia bilang kayak sorry. Tadi gue kurang fokus, gue lagi ganti pampers anak gue gitu. What did you need me to ask? Jadi kayak openly parenting juga on the call gitu kan.
Yes.
I think that is showing also the human side bahwa ya udahlah emang dia baru punya newborn, right?
Yeah.
And we need to start, you know, not start or like keep sharing household responsibilities juga gitu loh.
Yes. It should be celebrated kayak gini-gini sih, karena these little steps adalah yang akan membentuk sebuah culture.
Yes.
And that's the hard part.
Well, we can talk hours about this.
I know.
We can maybe days, gitu kan. But wanna be mindful with your time as well. So maybe a final question, yaitu adalah, this is more like a reflection because you've been working for kayak more than 5 years, gitu. Jadi pengen tahu juga sih, kayak what's your most profound learning or like lesson from the first 5 years of your career?
I've mentioned it before, but I want to say it again. Karena gak akan capek nge-remind everyone on it. Stop comparing yourself to other people. Like just, I know it's super cliche, but let's get real here. Even I catch myself doing it too, still, gitu kan. After kayak, you know, spending 6.5 years in total working full time. Every time there's just someone kayak, amazingly good, you know, apa segala macam, or they are perceived as kayak super fast speeding through life gitu kan, yang kayak have two babies at the age of 25 or whatever it is, you know, it's, everyone has their own journey, people. Mm. Everyone has their own journey. What you should worry about is comparing yourself with your old self. If your old self was actually a better self than your current self, that's what you need to worry about. That's when you need to really slap yourself in the face, right, with this ugly truth, because that shouldn't be the case, right? With your learnings, with the people around you, your support system, apa segala macam, surround yourself with people who can actually upgrade you to become a fuller, best version of yourself, right? And be very, very conscious in terms of where you have come and where you would like to be, and just focus on your own journey and your own self, and you will find yourself at peace. Trust me.
That's so powerful. Itu hal yang juga, well, gue juga masih belajar gitu kan. Karena,
silahkan.
I mean, like, without any doubts, it sounds super cliche gitu kan.
Oh, it jangan sounds super cliche.
Super cliche. Dan kadang-kadang yang bikin trigger itu bukan karena itu klise, but because it's so hard to do. Karena itu require kayak unlearning our past conditioning gitu kan. Karena, again, yeah, without blaming anybody, we were raised on like a ranking system. There is someone on top, yes, and we just need to chase that person. Gitu kan. Dan itu terjadi terus-terusan gitu selama kita at least sampai kuliah gitu kan. Kayak ada yang IP tertinggi, ada lulusan terbaik, right? Gitu. Dan begitu kerja langsung kan kayak, oops. Kayak, wow, 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 why some people are going so fast? Gitu kan. Padahal kadang-kadang kita lupa kayak ada juga yang sebenarnya gak going so fast gitu. Or maybe going to a different direction because maybe being fast is not the most important thing juga gitu kan.
Exactly. Again, yeah, success for everyone can mean very different thing. Very different thing, right? Banyak juga orang yang kayak happy banget and they find themselves successful even without any titles and anything. And that's completely fine. Kayak you define your own success and then just work towards it aja gitu. If you see someone, if you catch yourself kayak feeling intimidated by someone yang kayak perceive as super fast speeding through life, look at them as inspiration, not as a competition.
That's a good way to end this episode. Thank you banget dah for your time.
Thank you so much, Vicario, for having me. It was so great as usual.
Cheers, take care.
Thank you, Vicario. Bye-bye.
Thank you banget ya udah dengerin episode kita kali ini. Kalau lo suka sama konten ini dan merasa kalau lebih banyak orang perlu mendengarnya, please share this to your network. Karena itu akan membantu mereka untuk menemukan konten ini dan mentransformasi hidup mereka. Jangan lupa juga untuk follow kita di Instagram, karena setiap harinya kita akan post bite-size content untuk merefresh apa yang teman-teman sudah pelajari di podcast ini. Check out our Instagram at followyourflow.id. Terakhir, ada free course di website kita, yaitu tentang setting up your minimum viable priority, di mana lo bisa memahami prioritas hidup lo dan cara yang lebih konkret untuk mencapainya. Yuk, dapatkan akses di course-nya dengan check out our website di www.followyourflow.id.